Is this Steve?
Yep.
All right. Well, let me do the official introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, we are very excited to welcome our featured guest for this evening. He is a director and a photographic artist who has a beautiful book out that we want to talk a lot about. We are so excited to welcome Mr. Steve Carver to the show. You're on the air with Terry and Tiffany. Welcome.
Oh, thank you.
thank you very much. I must say, Steve, that as well as being, you know, definitely talented and probably what is known as the art of photography and touching up photographs, you must be really good at touching up yourself. I cannot believe you're 75. You look great.
Well, I don't feel that age at all.
Well, you certainly don't act like it. It shows.
Wow, we have gotten so much feedback about your book, Western Portraits, The Unsung Heroes and Villains of the Silver Screen, from people that have bought your book and said it's one of the greatest gifts they were ever given and or have given to other people, that it's just a masterpiece in itself, much like your films.
Well, thank you.
So tell us about the basic genesis of the book. We were not quite sure. When we booked you, I wasn't even aware that you even had a book out, and then it was recommended by a lot of our listeners that we get you on because people want to hear about your cinematic career, one of which, one of your big fans that you know in the business is Jesse Vint, and we weren't even aware that you had this book out, and we were saying between ourselves that it's kind of a recreation of the Old West and Old West type photography and everything, and that we had thought maybe you'd use different models or whatever, and I guess it kind of started out that you were using people that you found in the street. They were basically street people, but it evolved into using actors. How did this whole thing come about?
Well, it's a long story, and it's quite a journey doing this book, because it wasn't planned.
Yeah,
it was something that happened through sort of like an idea that came from an actor friend of mine, R.G. Armstrong.
Right.
Actually, what happened was that I was doing films in various countries. The country that started it all, because I picked up a camera that I hadn't shot still photographs for over 20 years. I gave up photography, still photography, that is, because with a big camera, a motion picture camera, doing film, I didn't need a camera. I wasn't allowed to use a camera on the set because of union rules. And having a big camera, you know, you're taking 24 frames per second. I had lots of photographs if I needed. Plus, I had a set photographer, and if I needed a photograph, he took a photograph, and I had lots of photographs.
So I take it you never took like your own photos when you're making films then?
I wasn't allowed.
Oh, okay.
Union rules, DJ rules. You can't take pictures.
Yeah.
Right.
So anyways, I had a great deal of background in photography and photojournalism in school and professionally. I did that, you know, to earn money and that's what I wanted to become, a photojournalist at one point. And I liked it a lot. Photography was a lot of fun, and I thought that was the route I would take until I discovered motion picture and directing, of course.
Mm-hmm.
But what had happened was that I accumulated so many negatives in Europe and the Far East and so on, where I was making pictures, that I decided when I came back to open up a darkroom and a laboratory, and I wanted to print these pictures, and I fell in love with so many photographers that had printed and shot gorgeous pictures and these historical pictures, that I decided to do my own. And in doing and setting up and learning about how they did it back in the 19th century, late 1800s in particular, and the artists, the photographers that I fell in love with, Edward Sheriff Curtis in particular, and Edward Weston, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
Quite a few.
You're probably like me. I'm just amazed when I see like the old historical pictures of like Buffalo Bill or something. And for the time, they were quite good, some of them.
But it's not only the photographer, it's the process and also what the photographs represent and what they captured and the technical aspects. If I went into it, it's amazing. I mean, there's a lot of chemistry and a lot of science involved and a lot of weird stuff involved that involves physics. And a lot of things I call and other people have called ghost photography.
Yeah, you talked about that at the Autry. I saw a little interview where you were at the Autry in honor, and they were premiering your book, and you were explaining to the audience about spirit photography and Indians. Yes. And what they felt about it. Can you go into a little bit more about that?
Well, I can go into a lot more. there's a thing that I hesitate to go into it because, you don't talk lightly about it and you don't talk superficially about it.
Right.
You talk deeply about it.
Mm-hmm.
In ghost photography, in the photography that I delve into and that I did with the actors for this book, it's a time photography. It's a photography that you take for several seconds that is comparable in the olden days because of the slow emulsion of the film that they used and the process that they used chemically, where you capture many, many, many things about the person that you're photographing, the person that who's sitting. And in motion picture, for instance, you're taking 24 frames per second and you're capturing a lot of images. In this photograph, you're doing the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Over a period of time or seconds, and in the olden days over maybe 5 minutes to even 20 minutes, the exposure captures a lot of time. And in this process, you're taking something away from the person. You're actually capturing something that involves their spirit, as the Native Americans see it, and as many people see it. You're capturing something that the human eye doesn't see, and it's ghostly in a way because, for instance, when the picture was taken back then, the photographer would walk into the time in which the picture was being taken, adjust the tie, adjust the hair, adjust the wardrobe, and walk out. And in the finished product or in the finished image, you don't see that.
Yeah.
But in the negative, it's all there. So like 24 frames per second or like motion picture, it's all there. And when I was printing these pictures, these negatives from the collectors and the curators in the museums, I was able to print from that same negative, that thick negative, all of these images. I would print maybe 10 or 12 different images from that single negative. So the ghosts of all of those times, all of those images were in that single negative and from that single time. Same with these actors who sat. They blinked, they coughed, they moved, whatever. Many, many images were in those negatives. And because these images were taken at different times, so to speak,
mm-hmm.
even though they sat for X amount of seconds, it's ghostly. So so to speak.
Well, they had comments from a few of your photography subjects, and they had talked about how long it took and how long they had to hold still. Was that surprising to them? Because, you know, you're kind of used to seeing a photography session like a guy is shooting a model or whatever, and it's all quick, okay, turn to the left, turn to the right. But yours is not quick.
No, they sat for quite a number of hours and quite a number of exposures and quite a number of poses. And sometimes I was surprised because I didn't remember any of the poses. I didn't remember a lot of the looks they gave, because it captures something that is at a different time sometimes. Yeah. It's ghostly and it's very strange. It's a wonderful process.
So in planning for your book, now I know you'd said that you hadn't taken photos on the set because you weren't allowed and so forth, but over the time, you have gotten some photographs of some of the actors that are no longer with us, such as Buddy Hackett, such as David Carradine, and so on. How were those taken if you weren't doing a book at the time? I mean, was that just something you did and then you evolved into a book later? How was it that you have photographs of those that have gone?
Oh, they sat for me. I knew Buddy a long time, and I asked him to sit for me. I started shooting the book. I'll go back to the story. When I came back from Russia and India and other places, and I had these negatives, and I started to print them, I decided to do these replicas for collectors in museums because their images, their historical images, were fading or mm-hmm. deteriorating in the museums and collections, and they had asked me to make replicas. I had gotten into some trouble with authorities in making these replicas because I was making them on old paper and making them better than the actual copies that they had, because I was making them from the original negatives, and they looked new, like the artist, the photographer.
So what did they hit you with? Was it like a copyright thing, or?
No, they would hit me with making what's known as counterfeits.
Oh, oh. Okay.
Oh. You're not allowed to make counterfeits because certain people were signing the name of the photographer, were forging the name, and selling them. And I didn't know that, and they traced it back to me, and I could have gotten into trouble if not for the legitimacy of my selling them to the collectors and the curators. But in any case, let me jump over that.
Right. Okay.
That's a little touchy. After I was told not to do this anymore, and I had a few arguments with certain curators from some of these institutions, which gave me a hard time because of it, I decided to make my own. And I wanted to just copy reproduce the process and create some beautiful-looking historical-looking images, and I started to use friends, and I started to use homeless people, which I was paying and feeding, to sit. But in order to do this, they had to sit still, which they couldn't because of their habits or their inability to do so. And I couldn't find people to do this, so I thought about who was trained, who had the skills to do it, to sit for a number of seconds, and believe me, these are long seconds.
Right.
Yeah.
And you had to have a skill to do it, especially if you're wearing a lot of wardrobe and makeup and so on. And actors came to mind, and so I called an actor, R.G. Armstrong, who I play pool with often, and asked him how he wanted to be portrayed. He said, let's do a Western. He's done so many Westerns with Sam Peckinpah and mm-hmm. other great directors, and he dressed up. We built a set, in my lab, in my very clean, perfectly, photographic lab, and we photographed him, and he was great. He did it perfectly, and that's how he one day over Game of Pool suggested, let's do a book.
It's a great idea using actors. You have to be used to it. I've worn those type of clothes on camera and for other things, and they're not comfortable.
They are for the actors, because what that did for them and for me, being a director and being able to sort of like give them a role, which allowed them to forego the hardship of not blinking, not breathing almost, mm-hmm. and not really caring about the camera, because this is something that really helped achieve these images in that they were able to project an image. And I'll tell you, one of the things that happens, and this happened with several actors, when an actor couldn't get into a role, say, or get into a part, or get into a mood, something that allowed them to not feel that they had to stiffen for the camera, mm-hmm. because when you're self-conscious in front of a lens, and I don't mean during a motion picture, I mean during a still picture, if you're hamming for a camera, you're not projecting an energy that allows you to bring this photograph off. There's a certain something that happens, and I'll give you an example. We had an actor who had cancer, and I'll tell you, this is a sad situation, because he came, and I'm trying to say this in a certain way,
sure.
where it's hard to.
It's emotional for you, I'm sure. Yeah.
Yeah, it's very emotional, because what happened was that. Let me try to put it in a different way to try to explain this to you.
Okay.
Let me first tell you what happened, and then I'll tell you who it was.
All right.
Okay.
The first time he came, he was on chemo and he was on oxygen.
Right.
So we had tubes to hide. And the first round of photographs wasn't feeling well. And when I processed the film, his face was totally white. No features at all.
Right.
Energy gone, no features. That's what this process does. If you don't have energy, there's nothing on film.
Right.
I asked his wife to bring him back. She brought him back 2 weeks later. He felt better, and there he was on film, and everything, his face was there, and it was a great picture, and it's one of the best pictures in the book.
And who was that?
I'm sorry?
And that was which actor?
Can I guess?
I mentioned it in my introduction.
Okay.
Well, that's good enough. I was thinking possibly. I know we recently lost Robert Forrester, and I know he's one.
No, it's not Robert.
Okay.
Okay.
Wow.
But you had actually started. I mean, the book. As far as starting the book, that was like you started like 25 years ago or something like that, right?
I started it in 1996.
Wow.
24 years ago.
And when you talk to some of these actors that you had worked with so long ago, I don't know how long ago, David Carradine, people like that were the ones that had passed on. At that point, did you know it would come to be a book? I mean, did they even suggest to you, are you just doing this for fun? Is it going to be a book someday?
Well, everybody since RG knew it was going to be a book because that's what I was asking them to come for.
Right. Yeah.
And LQ was next, and then David came in, Debbie Carradine came in, and actually everybody from that point, that early point on, were people that I had worked with. And were easy to ask and easy to come in because they were all my friends. And actually, I was either playing pool with them because we had pool parties. And,
oh, yeah.
And I had a professional pool table in my laboratory there.
Right.
Or in that the dock room that I had in Venice. And it was great. I'd play pool with them, we'd drink beer, and we'd go take a photograph.
It wasn't
that easy because the idea of having a lab and a dark room and setting up the set and then working all night and then having to clean it up all night and not have any sleep, it took 2 weeks in between each of the shootings, and I had a full crew. Robert Zinner, who was the master wardrobe guy and armor and props and artifact guy, he was one of the collectors. In fact, he was the one who brought by the first set of Edward Sheriff Curtis Oratones, which are gold photographs that I fell in love with. And he was a collector of those photographs.
Well, let me ask you about this. I totally understand what you're talking about with emotion and being emotional. I'm a very emotional guy, and it's very hard for me to get through talking about a lot of friends that have passed away and actors that you've really cherished. It was hard for me. I had Robert Carradine on, and it was hard for me to talk about his brother, David. It was hard for him to talk about his brother. How does Robert feel, or was it like an emotional thing for Robert in knowing that his brother, David, is on the cover, and you also photographed Robert? I mean, was that like a big emotional thing for Robert?
Well, Robert was there when I did David, and
okay,
and it's funny because I tried to get Keith, and Keith wouldn't come.
Mm. Keith is a little standoffish about things, but he's a good guy.
Yeah, but he called and really thanked me for putting David on the cover, and said that he loved the book, and he actually, I just spoke with him not too long ago, and he said if I do another volume, he'd definitely do it.
Well, I actually sent a picture of your cover of the book to David's granddaughter, who we are friends with, because I felt you really captured David like I'd never seen, because there was so many levels to David Carradine. I mean, about a spiritual guy, and you can really see in that soul like you're talking about. Definitely captured it.
David and I were very close friends, and I've done a number of pictures with him, and I had really great times with David in many different countries and in many different ways. Mm. He was great.
Now, you talked about that Keith didn't want to do it. You said something in the interview with the Autry that I thought was quite amusing. You said there was a lot of actors that turned you down, but you were also speculating, and it might have been because you had a different title of the book.
Yeah, the title had a downing title. Now I forget what it was, but it was
I believe it was The Dying Breed.
Yeah, The Dying Breed, that's right. That title, for some reason, I think that title was prior RG, even before we decided to do the book. The Dying Breed was a title that just came out of nowhere, and then when I suggested to Archie, he looked at me and said, "You're kidding."
Well, see, the first thing that would have come to my mind, you certainly know this as a director, and I know it as an interview, that the actor is superstitious, number one, and a little paranoid. So I can see why they were worried about that.
But I still used it because we all use working titles. I mean, I needed something. But the thing is that most of the actors who are friends of mine, like David and LQ, they didn't care what the title was.
Right.
They just loved the idea of dressing up, being in front of a camera, and having a good time.
Yeah.
I mean, that was the whole idea of working in motion pictures, too. You know, it's not the titles. It's not, well, it is the script, I guess, but it's not, you know, it's who you work with, too.
Right.
Well, I loved your photograph of Denver Pyle. I'm a big Grizzly Adams fan.
Well, okay, now you just mentioned him.
Yeah.
He's the one that had the problem with regard to the not being able to photograph.
Yeah.
All right, you mentioned him. I'm going to tell you, he's the one that did not register on film.
Yeah.
When somebody, and there were several other actors that had to come back, that if the energy wasn't there, for whatever reasons, if they had a bad night, such as having a hangover or something, and there are actors, or there were actors that had problems in black and white film, I should say, there are certain colors that are bad that I stayed away from, and one color is red. If an actor drinks too much and has a red nose, it turns black on black and white film.
Oh, okay, wow. Incredible.
Imagine having a black nose.
No, because you know, I can feel what Denver went through, because I too am on oxygen, and I was thinking to myself, God, it'd be such an honor to have you take my photo, but then I don't know if I could do it, and he did it, and I admire him for putting all that effort into it, you know?
Yeah. His wife, Tippi, really helped a lot. She brought him back, and he really made the effort the second time, and what a gorgeous photo.
Right.
Yeah.
You were mentioning in the interview that some people didn't really connect certain people with the Western film, but in a way they were. You had mentioned Buddy Hackett, of course, was in like Bonanza and stuff, but he talked about he had a big gun collection. They talked about there were other people, too, that people wouldn't necessarily know from the Western, but there was some kind of connection. I mean, what was your priorities for connection? Did they have to be in a Western movie or TV show or just a collector or what?
No. Actually, there were very few reasons for them to be in the book, other than the fact that they loved Westerns, or they had some small connection to it. For instance, you know, Freddie Dreyer, he was a source of a Western, of a Western novel from a British writer who used him as a source for his novels. And there were other reasons for him to be in the book. Which we have stated in his essay. You know, C. Courtney Jarna, who wrote the essays, he points out a lot of the connections in the essays of these actors, and some of them are small, the connections, but you know, quite interesting.
And it's not just men, it's women too in your book, right?
Yes, I tried to get more women, but that was surprising to me because a lot of the women didn't want to say it. Even the women that I worked with in pictures, they didn't want to come in because they didn't feel comfortable sitting in front of the camera in Western clothes and just in front of the camera, period.
Like I said, it may be good for actors to get into the role. Those clothes are uncomfortable. I don't care. But when you're working on...
We had lots of really great clothes. Some of those clothes that, you know, for instance, Robert, who you mentioned,
Robert
Forster. He's wearing Gregory Peck's boots.
Far
we have John Heston's clothes. We have lots of actors' clothes that, that a lot of these people in the book are wearing from great motion pictures.
And, you know, I
we
wasn't...
We got them from the studios.
Right. I wasn't even aware that he was still around. I was so happy to see one of my favorite artists and actors, Monty Markham, okay, who I wasn't even... I didn't think he was still around, and he looked good.
Yeah. Oh, he was great. And he's spitting vinegar. a lot of these actors are just fantastic. I'll tell you another thing about doing these. I try to explain on the telephone prior to them coming what it's all about and why I'm doing this and what the technique is and everything that I tried to explain to you about this quantum physics, you know, thing about what the camera sees and what the eye can't see and what the magic of this, you know, ghost photography is all about. You know, and I try to explain it, you know, sort of, you know, easily without getting too crazy. Because it is crazy.
Well, it's crazy, but I wanted you to talk about it because I wanted to show people that it's a spiritual thing for you.
Yes,
you know?
Very much so. I mean, I've lived with it ever since I picked up the camera. I was wondering why the camera sees things and I can't see it with my eye.
Yeah.
And that's really the truth about photography, by the way. Anyways, when I get on the phone with these actors and I call them, whether I know them or not, or I have met them or not, I get on the phone with them, they're hesitant.
Yeah.
Or they're curious, or they're this or that. Then they come. I meet them, shake their hand, hug them, whatever, friendly or not. they come into the studio. They're impressed with the set because we take 2 weeks to build the set. We have lots of artifacts. We have lots of clothing. We have lots of people on the crew. Everybody's knowledgeable. Everybody's friendly. And we're professional.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's professional. And we make them comfortable, and we do what they like, and we're very obliging. But they still are sort of like standoffish, or you know, do I have to do this? You know, and they're not sure that this is real photography, and they're not sure that I'm a real photographer, or what we're doing is really real or necessary. Because it's a big production.
Right.
Well, it's like with doing an interview with what we go through, is they want to be represented in the right way. You got to make them comfortable, but they got to trust you, and you got to get that trust.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Absolutely. Yeah. You got to earn it.
Yeah.
And we try to, and in some cases, it takes a lot of work.
I imagine it was easier for you with people you work with in the films, though, huh?
Oh, sure, yeah. Sure. Right. That's instantly earned because you know I did a whole picture with them, or several pictures. So anyways, they come in and we do their makeup, we do their wardrobe, we do everything, and they sit in front of the camera. I show them the camera. The camera is very weird because it's not a normal camera. It's a Hasselblad, but not a normal Hasselblad. It's a flex body, which is a studio camera that they don't make anymore, and it looks weird. It is weird, and it performs weird. It does all kinds of weird things because I have to take a lot of time in which to set it up. And, you know, in the beginning, you know, Buddy Hackett used to scream at me, take the picture, take the picture, take the picture, you know, and it takes forever to take the picture.
You know, I was just going to say that if anybody might have given you a little bit of hard time, it might have been Buddy Hackett.
Oh, a lot of them gave me a hard time. And normally I take 48 shots.
Right.
Sometimes I take 72. Sometimes I take more. Sometimes I take less, depending upon patience, depending upon a lot of things. But in any case, it takes a long time. And it takes a long time for them to relax. And it takes a long time for me to give the countdown and to get them in a mood. I just need one image out of all of those things. And I'm looking carefully for that image, but I never find it. I only find it when I'm in the lab later on, and way later on after I make proofs, way, way down the line. Mm. But in any case, long time, lots of time. They come in, hours pass, they take breaks maybe, sometimes they don't. Sometimes they just want to keep taking pictures, keep doing it, keep doing it, keep doing it. Finally, at the end of the day, I can't get rid of them. They all want to stay. Why? Because it was an experience.
Right.
Yeah, there you go.
It was something they never did before. None of them have ever done this before. So they enjoyed it.
Well, you know,
they had a great time.
And the people you work with, I imagine, you know, they would have recognized your style, having done a movie with you or whatever. But people that didn't, when you do this and you tell them what you want them to do, do you act more like a director or is it different? I mean, is the director coming around or is it more a photographer?
Yes. No, I relive my directing. It's like directing has never left me. I have the actor in front of me. I'm in heaven with the actor. I love the actor. I love directing, and I try to relate to that actor in the way in which that actor wants me to direct them. Sometimes I don't even say very much. The direction depends upon that actor, what they need and what they want. Sometimes they tell me to be quiet.
Okay.
Because I know that they need to concentrate on what it is that they need to do to give that energy to that camera,
right,
and to that film, and to, you know, send that image of themselves. Because I don't know what happens on that film, but there's proof in that book that every single image that's in that book is because of that actor.
Right.
Is because of that human being and that soul that they gave.
Right.
And I really think that I captured that soul.
Now, knowing that you kind of pull from your directing roots when you're doing projects like the book, let's talk about how you ended up becoming a director. Because you actually, you started out in school studying photography, and you were going towards, you know, being a photographic journalist and things like that. How did you end up swapping it? I mean, they're related, but they're very different jobs.
I can answer that question. He worked for Roger Corman. You got to know how to do everything, including you started out cutting like 150 trailers for Roger.
Yeah, well, you know, I went to the High School of Music and Art, and I wanted to be a cartoonist, and then I had the camera, of course, and I went to a bunch of schools, and I did film for my thesis at Washington University in St. Louis,
mm-hmm,
and I did a little thing at Cornell to finish up my undergraduate, but my graduate was more important to me as a fine artist than a photojournalist, and, you know, I worked for St. Louis Post-Dispatch and the football teams.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you did Wide World of Sports, and yeah.
Yeah, I did a lot of photography and a lot of film documentaries, and that's how I got into the American Film Institute out here at Greystone, when it was not a school but a place of film, where I had mentors, Gregory Peck and Charlton Heston and George Stevens Sr. and George Seton, who were great, and I met all the great directors, including Hitchcock and all of the great directors that came, and I was able to pick their brains.
Well, you talk about somebody with a photographic eye, Hitchcock. Wow, you know.
Yeah, he was something. I was lucky to learn storyboarding from him in particular, but also to learn, you know, that, you know, directors direct and really get involved with actors. And I understood right from the beginning, especially from George Seton and George Stevens, that, you know, a director makes the picture,
right,
as opposed to producers.
Hey, you know,
not
I can see
producers aren't important.
I can see a direct connection between somebody that has an eye for photography as to somebody that cuts trailers, because trailers are a lot of times the best part of the whole film. To be able to condense it all down to like that minute or whatever to attract somebody's attention, that is definitely somebody that would have the same eye as a photographer's eye, and that had to be great training for what you got into later in cutting right. 150 trailers or more.
Yeah, well, Roger taught me things beyond the American Film Institute. Roger taught me the nitty-gritty of getting involved in you know, the actual making of the film and hands-on, you know, working with the cinematographers and working with, you know, the crew and not just sitting in a director's chair and you know, just working with the actors only. You know, work with your crew and work with every department. And you know, Roger was the real mentor of filmmaking. He was the next step of making pictures, because one, we didn't have a lot of money. You know, Roger never had big budgets, so you know, you had to make things stretch and make things, put the money up on the screen and make the production value really work there. And that was the best education. You know, you can't go from school to CGI
for sure,
and then let them do everything.
Well, you know, I guess you did stuff for Roger Corman that I wasn't even aware of. Like, what was your involvement with Lady Frankenstein?
I cut all the trailers, and when I came back from Philippines or wherever, no, Spain, I guess I came back from. I had to recut the pic. You know, I recut all the features.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he gave me a moviola. I had to work at home, and I had to recut all the negative. And Roger just put everything in my lap.
Mm-hmm.
And then I had to go to Writer Sound and work with all of the people to redo all of the whatever came back from the foreign countries, Philippines or wherever he was shooting. All the directors were let go, and I had to take care of all of the trailers and everything.
Well, when Roger gave you the opportunity to direct your first feature, which was The Arena,
yes.
Did Roger have, I would assume he did he know about your extensive experience with being a photographer and a photojournalist and things like that? And the reason I ask is because if he did, it was kind of brilliant in Roger's decision making, because I'm going to tell you, Steve, you go back, we just went back and rewatched The Arena the other night, and you know, you can say a lot of things about a low budget film or this or that or whatever, but you can tell that as a director, you had an eye for photography, you had an eye for cinematography, because some of the scenes in that little quote-unquote low-budget film were so beautifully shot and so beautifully lit that it's artwork.
Well, I work with Massachesi, I forgot his first name, but yeah, the cameraman, I love working with cameramen, and I love saying, put the camera here, and that's how you work with cameramen. And all of the cameramen on a lot of my pictures won either Oscars or awards, and that's how I pick them. And I love foreign cameramen as well as American cameramen, of course, but I work with a lot of foreign cameramen.
Mm-hmm.
And they excited me, and yes, I love artistic photography in filmmaking.
Well, we had a question from somebody that works with the station, big fan of The Arena, and they wanted to know, because in watching what they believe was the two only American actresses, which was Pam Grier and Margaret Markov, they
yeah.
wanted to know, was that their voices or were they dubbed? They didn't think that they sounded like Margaret and Pam, but I thought they did. Was that their voices
yeah.
or not?
No. Unfortunately, they were dubbed. I sat on the plane coming back from Rome with all of the elements I worked with an Italian editor who didn't speak English.
Oh, that'd be rough.
And had all of the reels in the compartment above my head and in my lap and by my feet.
Oh.
Wow.
And unfortunately, I had a hand write all of the numbers on the side of the work print.
Wow.
And bring everything back, and we finished it in at New World Pictures in Rite of Sound.
Yeah.
And CSI. Or CG, whatever the place was in Hollywood, CSI, whatever it is, mm-hmm. Not CSI.
Do you ever look at any of your films like today? There's a lot of things going on in the news, and of course coronavirus and everything. But more so than that, as of lately, that horrific incident that came to be what we know now as Black Lives Matter. The terrible thing that happened to the person that was arrested.
Yeah, George Floyd.
But because of that, there's a whole thing that's kind of taken over Hollywood. You've read the lines lately of the newspaper that they've banned Gone with the Wind because of some racial, you know, innuendos, and Disney's pulling Song of the South, which they've done before. But like, for instance, in the arena that we saw last night, there were several things that a lot of people would be offended by today. Do you think that they should pull films such as even The Arena, like they were suggesting, oh, Pam Grier's black so she can dance, and, you know, things like that? I mean, what do you think about this whole business?
How far is too far?
Yeah, how far is too far? And because I asked Jack Hill about this, because, you know, he worked a lot with Pam Grier, and he said that at the time he was worried about what people think about how black people were portrayed, and he consulted Pam himself. And she said it was all okay, that it was done in a respectful way. Do you think they are going too far and extending this Black Lives thing and picking on films of back in the day? You guys didn't think about that stuff.
That's a hard one. And
it is.
I really don't know how to comment on that. I mean, if you really want to ask me about Drum.
Okay.
Right.
I mean, that would be really hard for me to comment on.
Yeah.
I mean, I have a great deal of respect for all of the black actors that I've worked with, and we had great, great respect working together, and there were no grievances. I mean, I got lots of awards from the NAACP working on Drum.
And see, that's a good point, though, Steve. I mean, even in talking about Drum, I mean, okay, while there might be things that are touched on that people are sensitive to in the film, it's showing, that film is showing both sides. It's showing the injustices that's happening with the white society. So even though it's about a slave, basically, that, you know, he's trying to be a pit fighter, and but showing the injustices, do you think it's important to show it? Because how are we ever going to learn if people don't see what it was and what happened?
A lot of the ways people react to it, and we're on your side of this. We're not criticizing anything that you filmed or anything Jack Hill filmed. I think film is history. I don't think you can totally change history, because you need to learn from history so you don't repeat mistakes that are made. But, sometimes I think they go too far. And like she said with Drum, you know, it showed both sides of the story. You think that that's a good thing?
I think it's a good thing. And I think the actors certainly, you know, think it's a good thing, because they wouldn't have been in the film to begin with.
Right.
For sure. It was done in a respectful manner, and they wouldn't have been there to begin with. I think about actors that I respected so much, like Manton Moreland. I don't know if you know who he is or not from the old Charlie Chan films, but the poor man just wanted to work, and he got criticized by his own race for the way he portrayed black people. It's just a shame, you know. I mean, it's a terrible thing to happen with George Floyd, but I mean, I don't think they should be picking on Gone with the Wind and stuff like that. I wanted to talk about this, because I think of all the films Roger Corman was a part of, I think his favorite movie was Big Bad Mama.
Not too long ago, I visited Roger, and he said that to me as well. So you're right.
When you hear that from the master, the man, okay, that's almost like the Grace of Hitchcock or whatever. I mean, that movie looked like it was so much fun. First of all, you had William Shatner back in the days before Star Trek when he could act. And the great Angie Dickinson, but let me tell you, those two girls, you know,
Susan Sennett and Robbie Lee.
Sennett and Robbie Lee. You talk about art, okay? The scene where the one sister gives her other sister to the boyfriend, and they have the little menage a trois thing there. That was just, that was so beautiful. Okay, just brought, now I wasn't looking at it in a pervy way. It was beautiful.
Okay, well, Tommy Skerritt liked it.
Well, let me tell you, I would have paid you to be on the set with Robbie Lee.
So I understand that that Paul Bartel actually worked on that film as well. He directed Second Unit with you, right?
Yeah. Paul was my Second Unit director, and he did a lot of the. He was a second. My assistant director as well. He did a lot of assistant work with me.
He made a great comment too about you.
Yeah, we had read an article where Paul had said that working with Carver, he was very well organized, had great control of the medium, and he referenced that your stuff was always a big success at the box office as well.
Nice. Yeah, I like Paul a lot.
You know, I heard something about one of the films that you were almost a director of, and it really didn't surprise me because we had Tom Laughlin's daughter on from the Billy Jack films, and she talked about her dad being a control freak, a great filmmaker, but you were supposed to direct Billy Jack Goes to Washington, and Tom was like, no, I want to do it myself. Now, that totally sounded like Tom Laughlin to me.
Yeah, well, I was directing it up until a point, Tom Karate. We were in Jack Webb's office at CBS on Radford Avenue, and Tom karateed a glass coffee table in front of me, and that's when I left.
Wow.
Well, that had to go well. I heard Jack Webb was a bit of a problem sometimes, like he didn't have a lot of sense of humor.
Well, I hate to say that Tom didn't either.
Right. Wow. You're in a bad position right there, Steve.
that wasn't a very good situation for me. I went to Washington with Tom and Dottie and the whole crew, and that didn't work out. Let's put it that way.
No, all is history. You know, there was a couple other guys that was known for martial arts that you were involved with, and one, of course, with David Carradine. You had a great friendship with him. What about working with Chuck Norris? And I want to know about when they teamed up together in a film, because here we have two bigger-than-life people known for martial arts. I mean, how did egos play into that?
You know, Chuck and David were really good friends.
Really?
And, yeah, all of that is hype, and all of that was meant to really sell the picture. And there was no animosity or anything like that. And the only thing that was in the contract for David was that he didn't want to be beat by Chuck.
Okay.
And in the script, we made sure that he was blown up or supposedly killed by the explosion, and that was that. He didn't want Chuck to kill him. And we agreed. So we designed the script for David to be blown up.
Wow. Well, you know, go ahead.
I just want to add that in the fight, there were some real blows given by each of those people, Chuck and David. They hit each other pretty good, and they decided that was okay.
Oh, good. Well, wow. See, he could take it. See, that makes me feel better, because we had Bo Svenson on, and he was totally dismantling the idea that David Carradine was really good at kung fu and stuff. He goes, oh, you don't know how to do kung fu, and it's hard to believe he didn't know how to do kung fu, and I'm glad to hear that. It was put this way. You know how to do it if you can take it and dish it out and take it back, because obviously he was a good sport. Wow. And you know somebody else that was a good sport?
Yeah, Bo's a good guy. I like Bo.
Yeah. Sure. Oh, Bo's funny as hell. But yeah. Somebody else that's a good sport that I really got a kick out of, probably the most dignified actor ever. I would have thought he would have been appalled, but I was so happy that you cut the film when you did, because I was watching Jocks last night. and I'm talking about Sir Christopher Lee, who almost got hit on by a transvestite and then the movie quit. I was just wondering how he would have handled that scene. Because
Chris did that film as a favor to me. He really didn't have much of a part, and also he just had fun in Las Vegas. Yeah. We treated him in Las Vegas as a bonus to doing that film, but I wish he would have had a better part. It wasn't a very good part for him.
Yeah, it was still fun to see. I mean, a movie that's got not only Dracula but Shaft.
You know, right?
Dracula and Shaft in one film. But what was Richard Roundtree like? Because you know, you envision him as Shaft and everything, and I really think he was more of a pussycat.
No, Richard's a good guy. He was an eye for an eye, and you know, I asked him to do Jocks. Jocks was sort of like a kiddie film. We were having a lot of fun in Las Vegas, and so I got some of the people that I had worked with on it, and we played a lot of tennis.
Well, there you go. What was the
RG had the most fun with all the girls.
You know, I can imagine that set was probably definitely fun because of that part.
Right. We got them all the pretty girls to play with.
Let me tell you, I refer to them as Up All Night, because there was a show called Up All Night. And I believe your show was on Up All Night. And I'm a connoisseur of those kind of films. And it was definitely one of the best ones for sure. What is your favorite film of all the films that you've done?
You can't ask me that.
It's like picking your favorite child.
You know, films are like children. You know, you ask someone, what's your favorite child? You know. Every film that I do has something about it and something that happens in the film during the making of the film and during the shooting of the film that's a lot of fun, that you remember, and that you work with certain people and things happen and things that you do that, you know, you remember or you just, you know, remember the people that you work with or the crew or the actors. So you really don't have a favorite. You just sort of like, it just stays with you. So, you know, I don't like to really say I like that film because it's my favorite. They're all my favorites.
Well, I guess it's hard because I know you storyboard everything, and you'd remarked about working with a low budget, and you said because you storyboard everything, like only 60% of what you want gets made, and it's got to be...
It's unfortunate because in going into making the film, especially during pre-production, which is one of my favorite times, you know, you have these big hopes and you have these dreams of shooting great things, you know, having Chapman cranes and helicopters and explosions and all this stuff, and then when you go to the producer or you go to, you know, to look up what's in the budget, you know, you just hope the heck that you find it on the set,
right?
And you can do it, and when the day comes and you look at the dailies, the reports or what you're actually going to get, you know, you just have to work with it and hope the heck you can make the day or that it happens, and you beg and you trade and you negotiate and you fight and you do all these things and you just make the most of it, and you hope the heck in the editing that you can put the film together.
What was your greatest disappointment of a scene you wanted to do that never got shot or cut?
I'd have to think about that.
Yeah. You got a lot of thinking because you made a lot of movies. Wow.
Yeah. Well, I made a lot of movies, actually, that you'll never know because I worked under different names.
Oh, okay.
And, yeah, always right. I can't really talk about them, but because of the DGA and because of being fined so often, you know, if you look up DGA fines, they're horrendous. I got fined so many different times because I did too many things that I shouldn't have done. But I've worked under different names, and I've saved a lot of directors, and I've saved a lot of pictures, and I've done a lot of things that I don't want to talk about, but I love making films, I love directing, and I love helping other directors on pictures, and I've done favors like you wouldn't believe.
Oh, I can believe
it. To do film. And I also, I've shot films as a cameraman that I love doing too. So I'll do anything if it has to do with film.
You never know who freelances. I'm not saying you did this, but I was on a set one time. It was for some magazine. It was kind of a femme fatale kind of magazine. And it was kind of a porn, but it also had a horror aspect. And I was talking about a scene was being shot, and I was talking about this great TV series I used to watch called Silk Stockings. And they were all like, thank you. I'm like, why are you thanking me? Oh, we were the cameraman on that. So a lot of people freelance in a lot of different areas. And I'm not saying you did this, but I'm saying there is a lot of people that do a lot of things under different names.
Yeah, well, sometimes you have to, and it's not the money. I don't work for the money. I work because there are certain people that I'll do anything for because they've done things for me.
Yeah.
So that's what it's all about. And this industry is a lot of fun when you do it that way.
Now, Tiffany was telling me that you told her, because we were talking about your book, and we want to briefly mention it again. First of all, when did the book come out?
It came out November 19th, 2019.
All right. Now, she had said that you had said something to her about proofs coming back. Is there another book coming out?
Possibly.
Okay.
It all depends soon on what the publisher tells me. Because he's in Switzerland, he's German. It was printed in Germany, and he's in Switzerland, and I have to get an audit and find out, and I'll decide if we're adding 17 more to make it 100 actors in a new edition, or if I'm going to be doing volume 2, or if I'm going to be doing another subject matter, which should be interesting, because I want to maintain and continue this process.
Right.
Because I think it's great, and I've also determined that I can do something with it to further the images.
What about a story of your life and your filmmaking? I mean, it's too bad you don't have any behind-the-scenes photos, so you couldn't take those and that. But because that would have been nice in a book along with your story. But what about something about you?
I don't know.
Why not?
I hadn't thought about it, but I don't know.
Then I can hear more things about Chuck Norris and David Carradine beating down each other, because that was that was interesting.
I have a lot of stories. I have a lot of stories about all these guys and everything. I wish I could tell them, because it would be really interesting. I know a lot of things about a lot of these guys. Mm. Not only Chuck Norris and, well, I don't want to say too much.
we'll get you, when the virus is lifted, we'll get you in the studio with some of your friends like Jesse Vitt. We'll bring out the bourbon and we'll loosen you up.
Well, I could tell stories about Jesse.
I bet you can.
There were some stories that Jesse told in some of these book signings. You know, there was a story that Jesse, told about David. But I have a better story about David, where David was on the motorcycle when we were doing Fast Charlie the Moonbeam Rider in Oklahoma, where we had this biplane that is in the picture, where Jesse's boss, who, you know, is a 19th century motorcycle race, and this biplane buzzes David Carradine on his motorcycle, and everybody thought that the plane came down and hit the wheel of the plane hit David on the road. And I got on the walkie-talkie, and I said to David, you okay? He said, yeah, no problem. And when he came back with the motorcycle, you know, Jesse was saying, No, he didn't. Nothing happened. And I called David. I said, David, you okay? Yeah, nothing happened. He comes back, and he's wearing a white helmet. And his tire tracks.
Oh my God!
Airplane on his helmet.
Oh my God!
I mean, these are funny little things. I mean, there's all types of stories I can tell about all these things. Just wild stuff all through the.
And see, if you would talk to Bo Svenson, he'd come off like David Carradine was like skip roping and growing daisies in the backyard. I don't know what the deal was between them, but yeah, David's a tough guy. Hell, wow.
David's one of the toughest guys I knew.
Definitely.
And, I mean, everything that the reports of what happened to him in the Far East were wrong.
No, it's wrong.
I spoke to him 3 days before he died.
Oh, he did. And he was looking forward to stuff, too. I mean, there was no reason why he would have done anything to himself. He had things going on that he was excited
about. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's why you got to be careful what stories you tell in this town.
All stupid rumors.
Yeah. So I understand, I heard from the Autry, last question here, is that you're going to be back into filmmaking too, is that right? Is that still going to go on?
Yeah. I'm really anxious and dying to do a Western now.
There you go, it gets in your blood.
Yeah, I wrote a Western and, I shopped it and, it wasn't popular to do Westerns. Maybe it still isn't, but the thing is that I have so many Western actors now and so many friends that want to do Westerns and producers and people that would work, on Westerns and I'd like to sort of like mention some of these people that I would love to work with.
LQ.
But LQ, of course.
Yes.
But these are people that I'd love to, and I'm sort of like working on scripts with people and producers, Gray Fredrickson, mm-hmm. who worked with Francis Ford Coppola, who wrote a nice piece for me on my book. But these are people that, we can shoot a Western in Oklahoma, and I have people giving me scripts that I'm pursuing. And once this craziness lifts, mm-hmm. I'd love to do a Western. But I have everybody who worked on this book standing by. I have Robert Zinner, and I'm going to mention her name, whether she likes it or not, Poppy Ruiz, Carol Hills, Linda Sixfeathers, who does hair and makeup, Cody Merrick, Danny Chuchin, who did the sets and special effects, Tammy Orloff, who's a stylist, let's see, Max Area, who's a photographer, Lance Todd, set dresser, Paula Cantu, who's a makeup artist. I have to mention all these people. We have some of these people are going to kill me if I don't mention them. Denise Ocampo, Chuchin Ocampo, who's a hairstylist.
Mm-hmm.
Please excuse me for mentioning these people.
No, take all the time you want.
Rob Word, who does Word on Westerns. He's a producer and a Western historian. Al Frisch, who gave me all the costumes—not all, but a lot of the costumes and the guns. Phil Spangenberger, who is True West's firearm editor, and he's the producer of the Wild West shows. He does all of the big shows here in Hollywood with the guns and costumes and so on. I had a ton of great interns that worked on the book. Jake Schmidt, Jincy Brown Jennings, Claire Reedy, Alyssa Valencia, Madison Dan Curvis. I know I'm missing a whole bunch of people, but tons and tons of people that I wish could come and work with me, and actors, and all the actors on the book, whether they're old or not, or retired or not, I'd love for them to be in movies with me.
And even though she wasn't in the book, Robbie Lee was I would love to see her again. She's not married to she's not married to Graham Nash anymore, so you know, she's free.
Oh my goodness.
Well, it's been so much fun. We definitely got to get you here someday. There's so much more to tell, and you're like an encyclopedia of film.
Well, a lot of unfortunate lot have passed on.
Yeah.
And I wish I could have incorporated them in the book, that that in the movies that I had worked with them, I could have put them in the book.
Yeah.
But and those that didn't want to be in the book, I wish I could have gotten them in the book.
But you know what, Steve, it's kind of the same thing that I tell Terry about what we do, is that for those that you did photograph that are in the book, that sadly now have passed on.
Like Denver and David.
Yeah. Because of the work that you did with them and putting them in the book, that is something that is going to preserve their gift to the world. It's the kind of the way that we feel, because we've interviewed a lot of people that have sadly left this plane after our interviews, and that's a piece of time that will always be able to be heard or looked at or watched by fans of theirs.
Yeah.
I mean, I was happy to see. I don't imagine, was Dan Haggerty in your book?
No.
Because I know Darby Hinton was a great friend of his.
Yes, yeah.
And Dan Haggerty would have definitely loved to have done another edition, I'm sure, because there's certain people put you in mind, and like, you know, you almost think they were born out of time, like they could have been back in the Old West days, for sure.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, Dan died right before I was able to contact him. Yeah. I remember when he died.
Yeah.
Well, I appreciate your story on Denver Pyle, because that was special.
Yeah, I it was hard even saying his name. I didn't know if I could say it.
I'm the same way. You know, that's why you're so good, because you've got soul and you can see it and you can hear it and you can feel it.
Because
these things mean so much to you, and that's why you're great at what you do.
Well, I want to thank you for spending so much time with us tonight, Steve. I truly intend on keeping in touch with you. We'd love to have you come back on the show another time, and hopefully maybe get out here and do the show in person. We can have a couple of you and your friends over.
That'd be great.
But I do really appreciate you spending some time with us, and also for coming on the show with such short notice. I know I only reached out to you maybe half a week ago.
Yeah, we got to find out, like, where can you get your book? Amazon, I imagine?
Well, the best place is Amazon now. Also, you know, I should mention Edition Ohms, the publisher. You know, they're such a great publishing company and publisher.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, let me just mention the fact that it took me 2 years and over 200 publishers before Edition Ohms stepped up. I mean, he came here from Switzerland to meet me and to look at the photographs that I printed of the actors, and then said, "We're doing your book."
Wow.
And
well, isn't it hard to find publishers that'll do great quality art books anymore? Yeah.
And isn't it a great publishing job and quality book?
Yes.
For sure.
I mean, I was just blown away how beautiful they made that book. And how what they did was they sent me the proofs from Germany, you know, by snail mail, you know, by post office and by special delivery. They let me look at them, and they did it in with the colors, colored inks, which is unheard of. It wasn't just black and white and gray. They used the sepia tones that I wanted, and by phone, by long distance phone, they adjusted the colors just perfectly, the way that I tinted them, and used the old fashioned chemicals, which are very toxic, by the way. They were so great, and I got to hand it to them. The Germans, fantastic artists, printers, fantastic, and Manfred Ohms, the publisher, fantastic guy. I have to say, the best.
Right.
I don't think an American publisher could have done any better.
Right.
That's too bad we didn't get to see Paul Bartel in a cowboy outfit, because that would have been perfect. I remember his Western, Lust into Dust, because you could have got Paul and Divine for the price of one. I mean, you know.
And I also have to mention, my God, what am I doing? I have to mention Stephen Armstrong, my editor. Mm-hmm. And I also, you know, I mentioned, of course, my co-author, Courtney Joyner. I call him Courtney, but it's C. Courtney Joyner. Please, I wish you can interview Courtney, because he would tell you a lot about the writings that he had done. But the editor, you know, Stephen Armstrong, mm-hmm. PhD, he's a professor at Dixie University, the college, the university, I should say. He edited the book, and God, where would I be without these people doing the book with me?
Am I right in knowing that you got a foreword written by Roger Corman?
Yeah, I should mention all these other things. What am I doing?
That's my job to prompt you.
Yeah, what's wrong with me?
It's not like Roger didn't do anything. I mean, he's made a few movies, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, before you sign me off here, hang on a second, why I get all these credits. Shouldn't I do all this stuff?
Go ahead. Go ahead.
Can you guys do this for me, please? you have all these credits in front of you?
Not
because
in front
I don't.
Of me, no.
Not in front of us, no.
You're on your own.
Hang on, why I get them? Because
okay.
I should give you all the credits and everything, because
you did send us great material, but you didn't include the credits because.
Yeah, you know what I should do? I should just get my book.
Well, we can wait for a minute. We can like tap dance or something. That'd be fine.
I'm such a terrible guy here. All right, so okay, Courtney is the co-author. C. Courtney Joyner, the co-author. Stephen B. Armstrong is the editor. Roger Corman did the foreword, and the preface is by Kim Western. He's the grandson of Edward Western, the famous photographer, and Edward Western was one of the guys that I got in trouble with reproducing for the reproducing his photographs for the collectors and the curators of museums.
Oh, okay.
I didn't get trouble with his photograph in particular, but I love his photography of
imitation's the greatest form of flattery.
That's right.
Yes. It's true. And one of the other quotes that I love so much, which I can't think of now because I'm thinking too hard, is that portraiture is performance.
There you go.
And that's a very important quote that I always had, and I always tell the actors, because that performance that they gave in front of the camera was very important to bring off the photograph, because it's not only just sitting. It's performing, and that's by Richard, the photographer, Richard, who I met so many times and I loved. Now I can't remember. Getting old.
Aren't we all? Aren't we all?
Yeah. The introduction, of course, in the book is by me, Spirit and Grit, how mm-hmm. this book came to be. And Courtney wrote Carved on Film, Western Movies and the Faces That Made Them, a wonderful essay by him. We have filmographies in the book of all the actors, all the Western filmographies by all the actors, and it's just amazing how many credits by all these actors.
It's amazing every once in a while Hollywood will still make a Western, but Hollywood has kind of turned its back on the Western. But I know that people still love the Western so much. The biggest thrill for me when I moved into this area was getting to go to the Gene Autry Ranch, where
Melody
they filmed
Ranch.
Melody Ranch, where they filmed a lot of the old Westerns and everything. And another big thrill was having Clayton Moore's daughter on the Lone Ranger. People just have a thing for the Western, and I don't, you know, there should be a comeback to the Western. Maybe you can be that great comeback.
I hope so. I hope I can be part of it. I won't be the sole person, but certainly I hope to be part. Now, one of the things in the book, and one of the things I must mention, the book has in loving memory not only of David Carradine and Archie Armstrong, but of my dog, Indiana.
Okay.
Right.
Now, that's important to me, not only to me, but to everyone who came to my studio, because my dog, who was an Australian Shepherd, a beautiful Australian Shepherd, she lived to be over 14 years old, she greeted every actor that came. Every actor loved her.
Nice.
And she posed with every actor after photograph. And she was instrumental in calming every actor who loved dogs. And just about every actor did. I didn't know any actor that didn't. But every actor loved her, and she loved every actor. And she was the mascot. Mm-hmm. And what happened was that when I asked Manfred Holmes, the publisher, if he would put a picture in the book in memory of her with David and RG, commemorating in memory of Indiana, the dog, he said he'd never, ever in his career. And his grandfather, who he inherited the publishing company from, never ever put a picture of an animal in a book, and he would be happy to, because he saw how much I loved her, and he saw from all the pictures that we took of Indiana with the actors and with everybody how much they loved her, that he would be honored to do so, and that's how she came to be put in the book.
And see, once again, that's why your stuff has so much depth. It's because you have soul and can feel, you know, like nobody feels anymore, and definitely. And you got to be a great guy, because in the video I got from the Autry, Robert Carradine refers to you as that some bitch he knew for like 20-some years.
Oh, funny.
So it's just too bad you couldn't have photographed John. John Carradine would have loved. I know John Carradine would have loved to have done this.
Oh, that would have been great.
Yeah.
Yeah, Bobby's a good guy.
Yeah, he sure
is. You saw Walter Hill and Francis's blurbs on the book.
Yes. Absolutely. So it's a definite
good guys.
Definite great gift for everybody. Is there any way anybody can get an autographed copy? Now, I know it's kind of hard through Amazon, but do you have like your own website you sell it on, or?
No, unfortunately not. And believe it or not, because the Autry closed down, I was supposed to get a whole shipment of books. I don't have any here, but if you happen to get one and send it to me, I'll be happy to have me and Courtney sign it.
Very good.
I'll hand it back to you.
You scared me for a second. You meant the epidemic. I thought you meant the Autry closed down. I was like, no.
Yeah, I mean, you know, closed because of the virus. But when it opens, I'll get a bunch and be happy to do that for you. Or if you get one on Amazon, send it to me and I'll send it back to you.
Okay, very good.
With autographs.
Right.
Well, I have a motto. I usually sign it, and it says, stay focused.
Yes. Yes, very important. Not only in photography, but in life, right?
Yes.
And my motto is, I love Robbie Lee. So it's a little different than... It's a little different.
Well, that's good.
Right. She was the ultimate hippie girl, but she played a damn good hillbilly, I'll tell you.
Well, she didn't marry that guy.
Yeah, and the other girl wasn't a slacker either. She was, yes, you know, Susan was...
Susan Bennett, All right, yes. Steve, I want to thank you so much for chatting with us tonight, and let's keep in touch, and keep me updated so that we can make sure to promote the next book, whatever it may be, that comes out. Okay?
I really appreciate it. This was a lot of fun. I had a good time.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we'll do it again. We'll do it again for sure.
All right. Thank you, and I really, really, really appreciated it, and thank you. And
absolutely. Have a great rest of your weekend, Steve.
All right, Tiffany, thank you.
Bye-bye.
Right. Take care.
You too. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.